That's a pretty good gifts here. I'm doing all right. We've got a special gift for you tonight. No, not yet. Special packages. Tonight on NEOtropolis, this is not business as usual. Welcome to NEOtropolis. We are not business as usual. Hi, I'm your host, Jim Evans. Tonight, we have a special show that will be a nice stocking stuffer for you. We've been very fortunate to get out and meet a lot of great people who've had a lot of great ideas. So what we're going to do is take a look back at several businesses we thought were worth another look. One of the most unique stories we focused on was a wind energy auto wrecking collaboration. PearlWind set a first for Cleveland with a wind energy turbine project. One of the main goals is to show that investment in wind energy makes good business sense. So as you'll see, they are not doing business as usual.
Welcome to the Pearl Road Auto and Wrecking site in Cleveland, where the owners here are definitely not doing business as usual. In fact, they've become trendsetters in Northeast Ohio by going green in a unique way. Juan Lugo and Cesar Montalvo are mechanics at a company that's ahead of its time, at least here in Northeast Ohio. Mark Henderson is the warehouse manager. These guys work for a company that's in the business of recycling. So going green is nothing new to the owners of Pearl Road Auto Parts and Wrecking. They've been salvaging car and truck parts and selling them to customers for many years. But now they're taking the concept of recycling to new heights, literally.
Well, what we're looking at here is Cleveland, Ohio's very first wind turbine for a business interconnected to the utility grid.
This 178-foot wind turbine was installed on the property of Pearl Road Auto Parts in September of 2009. It was designed to harness the wind for energy.
I mean, since I was a kid being on this property, it's always been windy. And the wind whips, the wind is always blowing. I mean, it makes sense that I wanted a windmill.
Yeah, right. John Kaplan's dream since childhood was to have a windmill on the property. He grew up in the salvage business, following in his father's footsteps.
No, I don't have that one, but I know somebody that does.
It was Myron Kaplan who instilled in his son a sense of respect for the Earth's natural resources. So installing a wind-driven energy machine just made sense.
Green is in. You know, that's the coolest thing everybody says.
John now helps his father run Pearl Road Auto Parts. They're both descendants of Russian Jewish immigrants who founded the company 83 years ago.
My father's parents came from Belarus, and I guess they came to this country in the early 20s. Grandma was the boss. She's what you call a balabus. And back in the 20s, she was driving cars, smoking cigarettes, and wearing pantsuits. So she was way ahead of her time.
Myron's grandmother, Rose Kaplan, founded the salvage yard in 1927, starting out the family business in nothing more than a wooden shack. In the 1930s, the company became known as Kaplan Auto Parts. Eventually, the name was changed to what it is now, Pearl Road Auto Parts and Wrecking, a thriving business that has helped customers buy used parts at reasonable rates. But like any business, especially in this economy, it needs to constantly change in order to survive. So why not find a way to save money? The wind turbine is doing just that.
We have a $24,000 a year electric bill, and if we can harness the wind to make our own electricity, I mean, that's a great idea. And on top of that, wow, if you had a wind turbine sitting there with our name on it, what kind of marketing is that? I mean, that's like unbelievable. And that's what happened. It's an icon.
An icon, indeed. Motorists who drive along I-480 can see the towering structure from a mile away.
Oh, the wind machine. I think it's a great idea. It's cool. It's something different. It's an eye-catcher riding past 480. I like it, and I've been doing a little reading about it. And I actually was a little interested in it, and I think it's a great idea to save the earth and conserve energy, well, making their own energy. And I just think that it's a pretty cool idea.
I mean, sure, you can go out west and you see them in farms, but to actually have one in the city and see it go. I mean, I go to restaurants. Hey, I didn't see that thing spinning today, you know, or that thing, does it ever stop? It's funny. Some people say I never see it running. Some people say it never stops.
David Malley, the vice president of PearlWind, a company that installed the wind turbine, says it was originally used in Spain for 20 years before it ultimately made its way to Cleveland, Ohio.
There's no shelf life on them. There's no end of year for operation. If you keep it well maintained, they could last you forever, and that's the best part about it.
David says wind turbines can cost anywhere from a few $100s to millions of dollars. To help offset the cost, the state and federal governments will pay up to 70% through a grant.
Ohio, for instance, has some of the best grants available out of any state. 40% of your project, up to $200,000 of the installation and purchase of the wind turbine, is paid for by the state of Ohio. The federal government, the federal 1603, the American Reinvestment Act stimulus bill, will pay 30% of your project with no cap.
So the gas tank's off. There's really nothing on this thing.
The Kaplan say they expect their turbine to pay for about 75% of their electric bill. But the best part of having a wind turbine is that it's not using up the Earth's natural resources, something that's important to them.
We want to stop this dependence on this oil, and I thought it was a great idea. I like it because I went green, you know, and it just feels good. You know, it feels like I've helped the Earth, you know, a little bit less oil, a little bit more free air.
What better legacy for a father to leave to his son?
Some fathers buy their children cars, and some buy them homes. But I bought mine a wind turbine.
If anyone's interested in learning more about wind turbines, they can stop off here at any time. The owners of Pearl Road Auto and Wrecking would love to encourage other businesses to go green as well in an effort to save the planet. In Cleveland, Christy Steves for Western Reserve PBS.
If you have a business or might be planning to start one, you know how important it is to try and stay ahead of the curve. One simple way to do that, of course, is with information. It's a premium commodity. Fortunately, today there are many sources to achieve that on multiple levels, and many people in the Youngstown area have the luxury of turning to the Business Journal for business news and information. We're fortunate to have the Business Journal as one of our content partners, and I had the pleasure to get an inside look.
The most valuable commodity I know of is information. Wouldn't you agree?
A fictitious offering, but with substantial merit. And for many in the Mahoning Valley, their source for the information of business is a hot commodity called the Business Journal Daily. Andrea Wood serves as president and editor-in-chief. She developed this product from its inception at a critical timeline in the area's economic history.
So essentially at the height of our industrial recession here in the Mahoning Valley. And our whole goal at that time was that we're tired of talking about the death of steel. We wanted to talk about business that was growing and prospering. And that's still our mission, is to build business in the Mahoning Valley.
Andrea was also a television pioneer in the Valley. She was the first newswoman as anchor and reporter at ABC affiliate WYTV in Youngstown, building a reputation as one of the area's top journalists. Seeking a new challenge, Wood blended a spirited sense of entrepreneurship with a unique local news perspective to bring her new project to fruition. The bi-monthly newspaper has evolved to a 45,000 readership and growing. But as the newspaper industry faces consumer challenges from competition with expanding media, she has sculpted her product in a way that has not been business as usual.
Well, we're not part of a large business journal chain. There is a chain of business journals, and they own most of them in the country. We're independently owned. We're owned by ourselves. Okay. And we've created our own product, our own template. We're not like any other business journal in that sense. It's very localized to our community. Our website is different than any other website here in town. We do an actual daily newscast on our website, and that's certainly not business as usual. The idea of television online is happening now across the country, but in many ways we were kind of ahead of the curve in that regard.
I'm Stacia Ernest, and this is the Daily Buzz for Tuesday, August 3rd, 2010.
Take camera two on Stacia Ernest, anchor reporter on the Daily Buzz. She too brings a wealth of TV journalism experience, also at WYTV, and then WPIC in Pittsburgh. Station and Andrea had remained friends, and that relationship and the eventual desire to return home and give back to the community with her work sparked the online business newscast concept. This is now an integral mechanism in the continuing evolution of information.
Now you have to be in all formats for everyone because a younger generation is more towards the web, the older generation more towards print, and we've done we're trying to do a real good job here of separating each of our products so that it's not redundant. So if you are a subscriber to the print edition, you still go on the web and see a webcast or read a web story, and it's something different than what you're going to see in the print edition. I think we're in the forefront, to be honest, here in Youngstown at the Business Journal in converging this journalism to a webcast, a print publication, and an online publication.
So the business of news is ever-changing, and that means the focus here is to continue to remain ahead of the curve.
I always tell the staff that we don't know what the platform is going to be in 10 years. Just like 10 years ago, we didn't know we'd be doing TV news on the web. But what we do know, as long as we focus on the content and we produce good journalism, give people things to read and things to watch that they can't get anywhere else, we'll figure out the platforms. Just keep working on the content. And that's basically my business plan.
Simple things like phone apps and different things that we're looking at to continue to reach different people and different target audiences. I mean, we're continually trying to make sure we're on Facebook, make sure we're using the social networks. I mean, we're expanding in all those areas because we have to, and that's what people want.
Valley residents also want a bright economic future. That's happening with new business, which has anchored younger people already here, as well as attracting many to return to the area. The Business Journal has been a specific model in what is a changing business dynamic here.
What I find most exciting in the Mahoning Valley is this indigenous spirit, this grassroots that has come up indigenously of people saying, we are going to make this a better place to live and work. We see an activism here that you haven't seen or didn't see years back when it was very patriarchal, very hierarchical, top down. And that's exciting.
It's been an education for me to come back as I'm doing this job and talking with people from the Youngstown Business Incubator, seeing what's happening with VNM. I mean, I really think we're poised here for a comeback, and I agree that younger people, I think, are looking perhaps to stay here. And when you go to the Business Incubator and you see some of the young people who are being hired by these tech companies, and it's kind of exciting at this point, I think, to be here at this point when I think it's going to keep growing.
And as the business landscape of the Mahoning Valley changes, what is the continued mission for the Business Journal?
Inspire people. Make them feel good about where they live. Feel good about where we live, and just show people who are making a difference. It sounds trite, but it's definitely true. Just focus on the content, and we'll figure out the platforms as they come.
Certainly in the Business Journal, you'll find entrepreneurial success stories. One of our previous success stories featured a woman who started a business simply from her desire to help other people. Deb Stanzak developed a new line of unique medical clothing. Her idea came from her own personal dealings within her family. The RonWear fashion line is so beneficial for both patients and medical staffs. And as Jennifer Boris shows us, this is not fashion business as usual.
For years, Deb Stanzak watched both her brother and her husband go through uncomfortable medical treatments, which inspired her to fight for patient comfort through her new business called RonWear Portable Clothing. And it's not business as usual.
I have over 30 years of retail experience with different stores. I was a regional manager for Ann Taylor. I was a fabric buyer with the May Company. I managed the Talbots up at Laplace at Beachwood. And then my last endeavor was with Fibers clothing store, and they were at Eaton Collection.
But it was her personal life that gave her the push to come up with her current business, RonWear Portable Clothing. Specifically, her experiences with the company's namesake, her brother Ron.
Yeah, my brother was on dialysis in 2004 from complications of diabetes, and he was very, very cold in the treatment centers. And I'm a seamstress, and I just went up to the store, bought a fleece pullover that was ready-made. I slit the arm, I inserted a zipper, and I threw it at him one day, and I said, here, try this.
Little did she know that it was the beginning of RonWear Portable Clothing.
And the next time I came in, he said, you have to make these. This is a tremendous outfit. Everybody wants one. The nurses have gone crazy over it.
But life for Deb was about to change again. She became a caretaker for even more family members over the next few years, and her idea was put on hold. Deb's husband was diagnosed with cancer, and her mom, who had congestive heart failure, was in and out of the hospital. Although she didn't have the time to physically start the company, the idea for RonWear stayed in the back of her mind as she began developing the logo and piece by piece developing how it could become a business.
And then I literally just gave up on it, and he had gotten worse, and then he ended up passing away in March of 05. And simultaneously, you know, everyone else was still ill.
Less than 3 years after her brother's death, Deb's husband passed away in January of 2008. Just a few months later, during a routine visit to the doctor, she was asked a question that gave her a push.
Dr. Jordan said to me, what are you going to do for the rest of your life? So, I don't know. I can't go back to retail. That was my whole life in retail clothing. I can't do that. My son is little. Everybody who took care of him has passed away.
He asked the same question a few more times, and she finally mentioned her idea for RonWear.
And he said, well, what are you doing this afternoon? And I said, nothing, why? And he said, why don't you go home and start it?
And she did. She reworked the original design she created for her brother, adding more openings on each arm, legs, and upper chest with patent-pending zippers that allow you to adjust the size of the opening.
When you're in treatment, you're receiving your treatment either, you know, in your vein through a port, a chest catheter, a fistula in dialysis, a groin port. You need accessibility and you need room for it to be connected. What patients are doing right now is they're actually cutting their clothes. They're slitting their jeans or they're slitting their clothes, especially in their pants, so that they don't have to disrobe.
Evan Coker has been a hemodialysis patient since 2005, and he's a big supporter of Deb's line. He says wearing the RonWear classic style of jacket and pants to his treatments makes it much better than it used to be.
Well, I mean, I had to wear like a thick flannel shirt because it's so cold in the dialysis unit. And I don't usually get cold, but because you're sitting still for several hours, it ends up being that you have to have something warm on. And so I would roll up the sleeves so they could get at my arm with the needles.
But now he's not only comfortable with drawstring and elastic pants created for any potential patient bloating, but he also has the ability to switch from zipper to zipper.
At the time, I had the fistula was in my left arm, and I just zip it up here, and I could get to where my fistula was down in the forearm. And you know, when the needles were connected and everything, I could just zip it down and only have a little bit of, you know, open, so you could see, you know, that everything was okay and it wasn't leaking or anything like that, which sometimes happens during a treatment.
The clothing is also treated with fluid repellent for any possible blood and chemical drippage. But what Evan also loves is that when you're wearing it outside of treatment and the zippers are all closed, you can't even tell that it's not just a regular sweatsuit.
It gives you kind of stealth that you can go among normal people and pretend to be normal and feel normal.
For Deb, this accomplishes the ultimate company goal of providing patients with warmth, dignity, and ease. But getting to this point wasn't always easy.
The part that I wasn't familiar with was manufacturing. I have never been in manufacturing. I've never worked with manufacturing.
Lucky for Deb, Susan and Bill Smith, who she used to work for at the fiber stores, now work for her. Bill as her COO and Susan in social media and marketing. And Susan had an idea.
And she said, let me call this one lady in Philadelphia and let me see what she's doing. She's used a local manufacturer for years. So she called Jody, and Jody said, you know what, I'd be glad to take you on. I can consult you through this. And I hired this manufacturing center out in Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Although there are challenges, Deb says being in a niche market makes things a lot easier because there isn't the same competition as regular retail. And it also looks like the demand will continue to increase.
There's a 500,000 people on dialysis, and the projection for that is to increase 6% a year in the next 10 years. With chemotherapy, you have 1.8 million people on chemotherapy, and the projection there is 21% increase a year.
Deb's come a long way since her idea for RonWear first began to take shape, and she thinks her brother would be proud of all that she has accomplished.
My brother was my biggest fan. He talked about me to everybody he knew, and everything that I did in my career, he was always so proud of. You know, he really wanted to make a difference, and I really feel like I can make a difference for him, you know, and carry this out for him.
And this is only the beginning for Deb. If her brother's right, she may just be on the path to becoming a millionaire and helping a whole lot of patients feel better about their treatment along the way. In Northfield Center, I'm Jennifer Boris for Western Reserve PBS.
Here we are in the season when we devote important time with family, friends, and food. At this time of year, so many of us have traditions that involve special foods. And here in Northeast Ohio, there is a very special family that is famous for its food. The Sandridge Food Corporation has provided its unique and delicious recipes for generations. You've had something from their menu at some time, right? Sarah Taylor did, and she gives us a closer look.
If you've been to a family gathering or a picnic recently, there's a good chance you had a visit from Grandma. This grandma, I mean. Grandma's salads are best sellers for Sandridge Food Corporation here in Medina. Celebrating its 50th year, this family-owned business has built a recipe for success. One big reason? Here, it's not business as usual.
We've got the new packaging being done here.
Meet the Sandridge family. Mark is the company's CEO. His sister, Tony, and his son, Jordan, work together in the transportation division. His brother, Mike, and his other son, Dane, work in sales.
I'm very lucky to work with my family. My family is very important to me. We run it as a business, even though a lot of us are family members, but we expect everybody to toe the line and do their jobs. And it's been very, very good, for very rewarding. I think our father would be extremely proud of us all, and that we were able to take it to the next level.
Vincent Sandridge started the business in 1960 in Cuyahoga Falls. He was new to the area, coming from West Virginia, fresh out of the Army. He decided he wanted to work for himself. His children helped with the business as they grew.
Our father was very, very difficult. There are no excuses, as well as my brother. There are no excuses with him. Very result-oriented people. And they push you and push you. But, you know, it's an honor to be here. And, you know, my brother always says, it's, you know, you're here to stay if you want, but it's your decision. So you kind of scratch your head. Well, yeah, I kind of want to stay.
I'm emotionally attached to this company. My father, you know, now my brother, we're all a big family-oriented company and a big family. I mean, we have our disagreements and, you know, family dynamics are like that at all times. But it's a legacy that you can't not be proud of. And when your name is associated with something like this, it just makes you really proud. And you come to work every day going, I need to do something to make it even better.
They've certainly done that. When Mark bought the company in 1997, Sandridge, which had moved to Medina, had 60 employees and 75 to 100 products.
Hey, Billy, how are you?
Today, they employ 450 and offer some 500 products.
Oh, it's huge. It's huge, especially during this time when you're looking at the recessionary period that we're going through. Their expansions have been significant. I mean, it helps maintain the level of employment in the city. You know, and that's exciting. Not only, it gives hope to other businesses.
Well, it's been a lot of work, okay, but we've got a great management team, and we've spent a lot of time studying the consumer, and we try to solve problems for that consumer, and we've been pretty good at it. We've listened well and presented products that fix things for the operators.
Besides Grandma's potato salad, Sandridge makes a wide variety of other salads and slaws, soups and chili, which they sell both directly to consumers and also to national chain restaurants and other outlets. The company is always striving to stay ahead of the curve. They take an annual trip to Europe, England, and Belgium mainly, where Mark says food manufacturing is about 10 years ahead of the U.S.
Now, people in Europe are into fresh. They want real natural ingredients and wholesome products.
Do you think that's the way we're headed?
We definitely are.
Mark has been recognized as a visionary, and with its most recent expansion, he's taking Sandridge straight into the future.
So welcome to the HPP Center.
HPP stands for High Pressure Processing.
HPP allows us to do two things. It kills all the bacteria in the product, so all the harmful bacteria that you're well aware of, the Listeria and E. coli and Salmonella, it destroys those products or those bacteria and produces a very clean product for the consumer so you don't have the chance of recalls.
How does it do that? With cold water and high pressure.
It's 87,000 PSI in there. And what happens is because it's equal pressure, it doesn't actually compress anything. So you can put a grape tomato in there, okay? You can put beans in there, you can put different things in there, and it doesn't change the texture of it all. But the bacteria doesn't like pressure. So what happens is it pressurizes the bacteria and the cell walls are so flimsy that it blows up and destroys the bacteria.
Taking out the bacteria does something else.
Do you notice the taste difference?
Yes, because you don't have to put all the chemicals in there and acids in there to, when I say acids, vinegars and stuff to acidify things to help them be preserved. So now you get to make product that you wouldn't make at home in an industrial environment.
When you go out and as a salesman and talk about this HPP, how well is that being received?
Oh, it's open arms.
It's just the latest innovation at a family company that's become much more than a mom-and-pop operation.
And I firmly believe other family companies, they hand it over, and the second or third generation will lose the company. Well, we're not going to. And we've opened and embraced our third generation family, and I think we'll be fine.
Sandridge is currently working on new packaging so that grandma's potato salad can go through the high pressure processing. So by next spring, look for a preservative free version of this old favorite. In Medina, I'm Sarah Taylor for Western Reserve PBS.
Our menu always includes a complement of entertainment and culture. Cool Cleveland's Thomas Moretti joins us now to tell you about what's going on in NEOtropolis this weekend. What we're talking about is the business of fun.
Hey, it's Thomas Mulready from CoolCleveland.com, and this week we want to talk about shopping local at your local museum shops. Now, a lot of the museums in the region have a shop, and a lot of them are stocking them with things that are local, that are cool, and it keeps the money in the region. We happen to be today at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Cleveland at their gift shop, and they have a lot of cool items. But there's a lot of shops throughout the region. For example, the Cleveland Museum of Art, not only do they have shops with their shop has home decor and multimedia, you can also shop online. They have a great online store as well. And with a lot of these stores, if you're a member, you often get a discount. So another good reason to shop local. The Maltz Museum of Jewish History has everything from these Jewish mezuzahs to Superman mouse pads. And they're out in Beachwood, so I'd recommend checking them out. The Akron Museum of Art has mix sticks, which are for mixing up in the kitchen, and then you flip them around and they're drumsticks. So that's kind of a cool item. The Butler Institute of American Art in Trumbull and Salem, they have a couple of additional locations throughout the region. And then the Holden Arboretum, they have their treehouse store, and they have a lot of gardening supplies out there. So you'll never know what you find. Here we've got some animal scissors that we found here at the Mocha shop at the Museum of Contemporary Art. Check out your local museum gift shop. This is Thomas Mulready from CoolCleveland.com. Have a great week in NEOtropolis.
So get out and help the Northeast Ohio economy by going to any of the events Thomas told us about and make your investment in fun. You can also position yourself out there and make some brilliant comments about the Northeast Ohio economy to the people under the mistletoe and tell them to spread the word. In the meantime, log on to our website, neotropolis.org, and tell us what you think. I'm Jim Evans. We'll see you next week on NEOtropolis, not business as usual.
Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the Burton D. Morgan Foundation, committed to the free enterprise system. The Dominion Foundation. JumpStart, working with entrepreneurs to accelerate the growth of their high-potential businesses to create a more prosperous economic future for Northeast Ohio. The Raymond John Wien Foundation. Youngstown Business Incubator.
Next week on NEOtropolis, we'll unwrap more of our favorite packages. Now stay tuned for Newsnight.